Each PIUnit batch can optionally belong to or be grouped under a PIBatch. And if we look at the PIBatch generator, you'll notice that every unit batch has a PIBatch functionality that's built into it. And one of the things you'll notice is that there is no trigger tag under the PIBatches. There's only a index or an ID point. There is a product and recipe or procedure name. And there's something called the PIBatch search time, and we'll get into that in a moment. But all these are optional parts of the unit batch functionality. And so first, let's look at how the triggering mechanism works for PIBatches. On the bottom of my diagram here, I have my unit batch trigger tag, or what we call active point transitions. Think of this as the trigger for the unit. Now, on the top section, I have my PIBatch index point or ID point transitions, and you notice that this tag is very active. However, the diagram is a little bit misleading to people who aren't familiar with the way PIBaGen works. PIBaGen only reads the PIBatch index point when the unit batch transition occurs. So, when the first unit batch transition occurs, we read the index point and we evaluate that and see what that number is, and we associate that with the unit batch. Now, when the additional transitions come along, it has no impact because we are not reading the batch index point at that time. We don't read the batch index point until the next unit batch transition comes along. Now, when we evaluate the batch index point at the next unit batch trigger, if that index point value is the same as the previous unit batch trigger, we will assume that both of these units belong to the same PIBatch. If, however, that value is different, PIBaGen will associate this second unit batch with a different PIBatch. So the unit batches are only associated with one another based on the batch ID point's value when they start up, or I should say when they're evaluated. So when the unit batch evaluates its data, it looks at the PIBatch point and either associates itself with one or the other depending on what those values are. So that means that if you have two unit batches running and they do belong to different PIBatches, you need to make sure that that PIBatch index point changes correctly between the two start times or the evaluation times. Because there's no trigger for the PIBatch, we have to figure out a logical method or use some logic to associate the unit batches with the PIBatches that may be currently running. And so we apply a certain methodology. That methodology is controlled by what you enter into your PIBatch settings. Your product name and recipe name and index point are all looked at, as well as the PIBatch search time. That's usually specified in number of hours, and so you'll have to make sure you tweak that or change that if you potentially have unit batches that have breaks in their run times longer than 4 hours. Let's take a look at some diagrams here and look at how this logic is applied. We have a 4 hour recovery time, and we apply that in a plus and minus. The plus really only comes into play if we're doing recovery of things. It's future time effectively. And we apply it when the evaluation time hits for the unit batch. So let's say, for the sake of discussion, there's a 5 minute delay. So 5 minutes after the start of the unit batch, we apply our 4 hour time and we look at what was running during that 4 hour period of time. Now, I've got five PIBatches illustrated here. I've got two that were closed, B0 and batch 1. Batches 2, 3, and 4 are running and have not closed out. And let's say, for the sake of discussion, we match all of them on product and recipe. So which one do we associate ourselves with? Well, if we look at all the batches that were running within the previous 4 hours, we would see that there are four of them running, and there are three of them that are still open. So we will associate ourselves with the last or newest PIBatch, assuming that we match all the criteria. Of course, if we don't match any of the criteria, we'll simply start a new PIBatch for ourselves. Now, if we look at another instance where we have the same number of batches that we match, but only one is currently running, then we will associate ourselves with that, the currently running batch. And finally, if we match a series of batches and none of them are running, they're all closed out or stopped, then we will again associate ourselves with the latest PIBatch and then reopen that one. So the PIBatch search time is very important if you're going to associate the unit batches to the correct PIBatch, and you want to make sure you have enough time where it associates itself with the correct PIBatch. The final step in creating our unit batch is to register it. Now, registering it is different than saving it. You want to make sure that you save your work as you go through your batch generator configuration, and you want to make sure that whenever you make changes, you do save them as often as you can. However, you want to make sure that you don't register your PIUnit until everything is configured with your module database view and with all of your configurations, because as soon as you register the unit, the PIBatch generator is going to evaluate your parameters, your setup. It's going to try to validate all that information and start collecting batch data. And if you haven't completed it yet, you're going to get potentially a number of batches with incomplete information. And worst case, you may get batches that are completely wrong. So you want to make sure that before you register your batch units, you have all of your configuration correct. Registering it is very simple. You just click on the register the PIUnit button, and that should appear under registered units. Your PIBatch generator should then be generating or picking up batches for those units.